off and rolling. Day one, we're going to be talking about what types of insurance there are in the marketplace, what they cover, why you might need them, and some of the pros and cons of having them. So let's get going. All right, so the first type of insurance that we're going to be talking about is property insurance. Basically, you could think of this as insurance that covers your stuff. So if you're a homeowner, it's your home. Also, you have property coverage included in your auto policy. If you're a business owner, you want to cover your office, your place of work, if you're a retail shop, if you are a office, a white collar like office, commercial office, it's going to be the physical location that your office is at. It's also going to be, for companies that use or organizations that use a lot of equipment. Think of it in terms of your computers, desks, chairs, even specialized equipment that's stored at your location in a garage or something like that. If you're a contractor, a lot of your building and a lot of your building and landscaping and earth moving equipment, a lot of that's going to fall under a property policy in one way, shape, or form. So property coverage, always remember that my stuff, I want it covered both at the location that I work at and also if I ever have to move it around anywhere. Now, included in the discussion with property coverage is flood insurance. It's a misnomer that people don't have a building or property in a flood zone. Every property is in a flood zone. It's just a matter of time as to whether or not your property is anticipated to flood within a year, 100 years, 500 years, or out into the future. But just because you're not in a what would they would call a special flood hazard area, which is the shore right next to a body of water, doesn't necessarily mean that you're immune to flooding. All right, finally in the property area is crime and theft coverage. Crime and theft can apply to people from outside your organization, your company, your home, that come in and take things away from you, or destroy your property. It can also mean internally, meaning employee theft or family members and things like that that might end up taking things from you. So always remember that crime and theft coverage is to cover your property, and it applies both internally as well as externally, for who might take it. All right, a pretty specialized type of property insurance is called inland marine or a floater policy. When I was talking before about property that might be stored on location, if that's property or equipment that has to travel around to go to job sites or be loaned out and things like that, when it's moving away from your actual physical location, but it's in use or it's being handed off to someone else to use it as part of your business, that needs to be covered away from that location, away from your physical location as well. So you're going to need to have a floater either included in your property policy or if you have to write, you have to write a separate one to make sure that that's covered. All right, the next thing we're going to talk about is covering the liability of your operations. So while you're doing whatever it is that you do, making sure that you're covered in case someone sues you, basically claiming that you are negligent and hurt them or damaged their property or something. So the first type of liability coverage is general liability coverage, and it's just that, it's general. It has to do with your general operations, your general daily ongoing, and it covers you for both property damage as well as bodily injury to someone else. So not someone within your organization, but someone from outside of it that might end up filing a legal claim against you. The next type of liability coverage that we're talking about is auto liability coverage, and auto liability covers your vehicles. And again, auto liability coverage is a coverage in case you get in an accident and you injure or damage someone else's property. So it's going to be someone from outside your organization that is going to be making a claim that they had their property damaged or they were hurt by your negligent use of a vehicle. All right, I touched on it before, but auto physical damage is property coverage for your vehicle while you're operating it or even when it's just sitting parked or stored. So always remember that an auto liability policy can be written just with liability coverage. And in a lot of cases, they can tack on property coverage on there, or there's also the option to have that property coverage for your vehicles standing alone or on its own on a property policy that's covering other things like your building and your equipment. All right, another form of liability is called professional liability. But professional liability has a lot of other names that get thrown around. Some of them differ a little bit in terms of when someone says one thing, one type of professional liability versus another, because typically they're referring to a policy that has slightly different wording. But you'll see this, the names kicked around like errors and omissions coverage, malpractice insurance, or professional liability. And so any of those really apply to someone who is providing a professional service or product, and if they end up doing their job incorrectly, and for instance, the classic case is, you know, an architect that improperly designs a building, and as a result of that, the building after it's completed collapses or collapses in the middle of being built. So this covers you for traditional, you know, malpractice liability or errors and omissions type coverage. An error and omission would be considered, you know, if you were an accountant and you were doing bookkeeping or filing taxes, and you know, there was an error that caused a client to have to pay a penalty, or you forgot to include something and that resulted in your client being out money or having to pay a penalty, that would cover that situation. All right, the next one that we're going to talk about is pollution liability. Pollution liability is basically covers you either for cleanup at your own premises, or also it can cover third parties outside of your organization, such as you know, neighbors or other people that might come in contact with pollution that might have been generated by you, or not necessarily generated by you, but started on your property and ended up leaking onto their property, or got into the water and traveled and they ended up ingesting it. And so it covers for both property damage and bodily injury. Pollution liability can get very complicated, so you're definitely gonna wanna ask a lot of questions about what it covers, why you might need it, and if it's covering all of the different situations that you might have. All right, the last type of liability we're gonna cover, last type of liability coverage that we're gonna cover is called cyber liability. It's a very big thing right now with all of the hacks and a lot of the malware attacks and things like that have been going on. So cyber liability, interestingly enough, it doesn't really mean that you've been negligent, so to speak, in your ongoing operations, though sometimes that can result in you having a cyber liability claim. But cyber liability really covers you and your information and your property from outside attacks that typically come in from a computer or into your network. There's also cyber liability coverage for other people. So if you store their information, if you have access to it, or in a lot of cases, if you have access to someone else's system, and then someone hacks you and gains access to that third person's system through your portal that you were given to have access to their system, you can be liable in that situation. So I'm pretty sure in this day and age, 99% of businesses and organizations need cyber liability, because the saying is that there's two types of people in this world: people that have been hacked and they know it, and people who don't think that they've been hacked but they actually have, and they'll eventually find out that they were. Okay, covering your workers. So if you have employees, or if you have 1099 people that help you, or even in certain situations volunteers and things like that, there is a couple of coverages that we have to talk about. The first one is workers' compensation insurance, which pretty much everyone has heard of, but there are some complexities about workers' compensation insurance. One of those is that the second type of insurance that we're going to talk about is called employer's liability insurance, and they're typically written together, though you can write them in a separate, but typically it doesn't make any sense. You're usually going to get them together in the same policy. And what the two of them cover you for are injuries on the job to your employees, or, you know, in the course of their employment and doing their job. Workers' compensation and employer's liability cover a broad range of things. It also depends on the state that you're in. So certain states are going to have certain thresholds of liability for employers. I'm based out of New Jersey, and so in New Jersey, the threshold is pretty much strict liability, with the sole example of someone fraudulently putting in a claim, it not being covered. But in most cases, it's assumed that it's a covered claim if the employee was in the act of doing their job, or even kind of in the act of doing their job. It covers both sudden, kind of catastrophic or accidental injuries, and then it also covers, in a lot of cases, those kind of repetitive injuries or exposure issues that happen at certain jobs, where employee can develop something, a health condition or an injury over time. And that's actually why workers' comp and employer's liability is written together, because they both pair up to cover those sudden and instant claims and those claims that kind of fall over a larger period of time. Okay, so the last section that we're going to talk about is essentially the miscellaneous section. And this is the section that can really get complicated, and you're really going to want to work with your broker or your risk manager on this, because they're going to have to know the ins and outs of your business. So there are certain types of coverages that are specific to certain areas, certain industries, certain types of organizations. Things like trade credit insurance, which is insuring your receivables, so that when you send out product or someone does a lot of business on account with you and you're worried that they might not pay you on what you've done for them or the goods that you've provided them, you can actually insure those receivables. There's also product recall insurance. And so if you're a manufacturer or a distributor, a large recall can be a very costly claim, and for two reasons. Getting the product back is always a cost. If you have to destroy the product, then you're losing the value of that material or that product that you made. And then also there's a huge PR hit that can happen. Think back to things like Johnson & Johnson with their issues with aspirin and some other products. The PR element of it is very important, and typically PR help gets included in the policies that get written for product recall. There's also aviation liability insurance, so you can do that if you have to fly planes for your business. But aviation liability insurance can also be covered or carried by an employer that charters a lot of flights or sends employees on a lot of flights using small planes. And in a lot of cases, if you send an employee on a plane and say charter a flight for them, and a situation happens where the plane crashes or hits someone or something, they can actually sue you for chartering the flight as well as the company or the individual that's flying and operating and maintaining the plane. All right, the last thing that we're going to talk about is kind of agricultural insurance, crop insurance and livestock and insurance. So if you're a farm owner, if you're any kind of food processing organization that grows its own or has a lot of farm animals on their premises that they maintain for any one of a number of different products, whether it be fur or wool or anything, you can actually cover the health of the animals. And then also crop insurance covers the health of the crops, and in some cases will actually cover the yield of the crops to make sure that you don't go through a bad patch in terms of the yield on the crop and have to take a huge financial hit as a result of it. All right, so that's day one. Thank you very much for watching this video and thinking about risk management. I hope you liked it. We're gonna have 29 more of these coming, so definitely look out for them in your email or subscribe to us on YouTube to get it automatically in your YouTube feed and channel notifications. So if you have any questions, please leave them in the comments. Like the video. Please share it if anyone you know might be interested in it. And we're going to keep pumping them out. So I'll see you on day two.